Good afternoon, everyone. This is 287. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I hope you have a happy and a blessed Sabbath. Now, today's study may step on some toes, ladies, because it's mainly geared towards you. And it's about modesty in dress and appearance. And I know the world has a very strong hold when it comes to this area in terms of what you wear, how you look, makeup, jewelry, all these things. But the Father has spoken on this in several places in Scripture. So I'm just going to give some of what He says about these things. And keep in mind, He gives us free will to do anything we want. So if you don't agree, that's fine. But as a believer, I implore you, read, study the Word, and let the Spirit work in you and help you in your decision making in these things. We all have free will to do what it is we choose to do. So, with that being said, let's move on. You know, modesty in dress used to be considered old-fashioned. That's why it's been so much done away with. But it is making a comeback. And this hasn't been a good 100 years in the making to come from modesty to everything but now. So, if you see a woman today that's modestly dressed, then she stands out to those of us who aren't enamored and drawn to the attention-seeking dress that women are prone to wear on a common basis nowadays, if wearing anything at all, pretty much is what it's amounted to. So we have to be sure to really pay attention to what's going on and what we're perceiving. Now, 1 John 2:15 says that, "Love not the world, neither the things of the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him." If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. He didn't say you can do part of one and part of the other. There's no gray area. If you're in the gray area, you don't love him, you love the world, because that's what has a hold on you. Either he has and his word has a hold on you, or the world has a hold on you. And it's deceiving you and thinking that you're partially here and partially there. That's deception right there. So Deuteronomy 22:5 reads, it says, "The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth to a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment, for all that do so are an abomination unto the Lord thy God." Now, some will say, this is Old Testament. And I'm going to say, so what? Why would the Father change? Malachi 3:6. He says, "For I am the Lord, I change not." Hebrews 13:8, "Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever." So he hasn't changed. Why do you think his word would change? If you lay down a rule, a law for one of your little children as they get older, do you change that rule? No, you don't. It is what it was then. Now, there are things that we're allowed to do at certain ages that we aren't allowed to do at certain ages. Those things change, but those aren't concrete. Like the Father's word, what he says is he changes not. See, we change. He doesn't change his word. Now, even though we live under grace today, I still think that this verse applies to us as individuals, especially women. Women shouldn't wear men's clothes, and men shouldn't wear women's clothes. But let's talk about men for a second. Men are doing it. Men are wearing skirts. Men are wearing women's leggings and dresses and all these things. And let's take that a step farther. Men are wearing complete women ensembles. We call that being in drag and all this other stuff. See, now, the world has deceived us and convinced us for so long that it's okay that we think nothing of it when we see men dressed as women. We dress as women and the world thinks nothing of it. The Father's word says that we aren't to do this. This is an abomination. But see, we dress this up as Hollywood and make-believe. But so many of these make-believe men wearing skirts and dresses and women's leggings and blouses and underwear and full attire and wigs and makeup, so many of them aren't what you think they are. They're deceiving you just as they're being deceived. They're not only wearing, they're doing. But so many of them claim they aren't. Oh, this is for a movie. This is for that. Don't believe the deception. The enemy has a plan that's ruining this nation, or the world for that matter. Men have become so effeminate because of plans that have been set in motion that no one thinks anything about it. It's subtle. I'm telling you people, it takes time. This didn't happen overnight. But think about this. 25 years ago, men didn't dress in drag and all this for movies and on stage and all this other stuff that we see them doing. But we think nothing of it today. But this started way before that. It's subtle, and it just gets progressively bolder and bolder. Women, on the other hand, also wear dresses and skirts. So right there, we have some gender confusion. You could be walking behind someone. Nowadays, you don't know till you see their face, if then, whether they are male or female, because they're dressed alike, both men and women. So the world is already living in confusion based on little things like that. Now, people think that it's okay for men and women both to wear pants as long as there's a clear delineation between one type being specified for men and one type being specified for women. Now, it would be great if the Bible said women should only wear dresses and that men should only wear trousers. You know, that would make it easier, a lot easier to interpret this scripture, 22:5, Deuteronomy 22:5 in scripture. But the Bible doesn't say that. Instead, it commands women to wear women's garments and men to wear men's garments. So the act of one gender wearing the other gender's clothing is described as an abomination. An abomination, when it comes to scripture, that's way up there in terms of something that's really egregious and abhorrent to the Father. We have to understand how strong an abomination is. You know, the world suggests that it's perfectly fine for women to wear pants. Most churches these days even believe that it's okay as well. You know, we're not called to follow the world's traditions when it comes to things of this matter. We are called to follow the Father's words. And this is something that people are reluctant to do and keep looking for excuse to kind of not do or just partially do. Colossians 2:8 says that beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Yeshua. So we have to be very careful to not be deceived by the world. Look, this verse is a constant reminder that worldly philosophies are going to contradict the Father's teachings. The world thinks that slacks are okay and perfectly fine for women to wear these days. Traditionally, though, men wore trousers and women wore dresses. It's easy to see the difference because they're gender specific. And I'm going to say this, ladies, wear what you want, you have free will. Don't change or don't not change or what have you because I'm speaking on it. But I'm telling you what the word says. My opinion, though, is of no matter. I'm a man, I wear pants, and that's not going to change. And like some men, we see it's changing. Men in drag and skirts, skinny whatever, metro suits, metro shirts, ladies' pants, whatever, are a true sign of this world in confusion. Look, and it's not just regular everyday confusion, it's gender confusion. This is causing the world so many issues. The world is teaching that everything is okay and that any of us that disagree, we're the enemy. We're the enemy of your freedom. We're the enemy of your free thinking. We're the enemy of your free choice. Look, the Father gives you free will, like I said, and I'm going to keep saying, He gives you free will to do any and whatever you want. But there will be consequences. He doesn't force any of us to stop doing anything. But He's the one that's going to be the judge in the end. So, I'm with Him. If He says do this, I'm going to work my hardest. I'm going to be my most determined to do what He says according to His word. You know, the saying used to be that men wore the pants in the family. Now everyone wears skirts, pants, leggings, whatever. So no one's sure of who's doing what, even in the household anymore. It's another reason why there's so much confusion in the household. Most households, you don't know who the man is or the women. And then in some households, you got some of both. or both doing both, or two of the same in some households. It's total chaos, gender confusion at every level. Now, this is kind of how this all started. And women who are emancipated, it just throws them into a world of chaos, because they'll be out there screaming and hollering that people like me are trying to set you all back 100 years, because this was been about in the 100 years of the making. But see, women like Susan B. Anthony started stuff like this in the 1800s with this women's movement stuff. Now, I'm sure that for the better part of it, it was well-intentioned in this ideology, but like I said, it has destroyed the family, because you started this snowball going downhill, and it has grown into every aspect of our life, even little simple things about like how we dress. See, when she was growing up, when she was coming up, women wore dresses and all these things. I'm sure she had no idea that because of her drive and desire to push forth the movements of freedom and choice for women, that it would lead to all this chaos, because it has. It's blurred all the lines, and people have went to the wayside in every direction. Now, pants may have seemed like an okay idea at first for women to wear, and even today at a lot of levels, it still seems like an okay idea for women to wear, but what has went from something worldly, but may have been modest in its start, has turned to what? Jeans and slacks that emphasize a woman's backside, her hips, and her crotch. It emphasizes everything sexually about a woman. And women have all fallen into that trap, trying to outdo one another and be as sexy as they can be. Now see, this is why the word says things like it says. Women are to wear dresses and skirts, because see, the father knows all. He knew it would lead to this kind of chaos. Watching our little girls and our teenagers today in these low-rise, hip huggers, sexually identifying jeans and pants and shorts and all this stuff, we can all identify with it. See, you all, especially as grown women, you're out here wearing all this stuff and dressing all these ways. Do you feel the same when you see your little girl in this stuff? And if you do, that says a lot for how comfortable the world has made you in all this. I'm just saying, I don't find any appeal in that in seeing little girls, mine or any others, and grown women. I see the sexual appeal in all of that. I am a man, but women, you have to consider, what does this really say to a man in terms of how he's going to treat you, or how he can treat you, or how you appear to him? Now, for me or anybody else to say that women should only wear skirts or dresses, that's an argument in futility. But the Father's word truly does not compromise unless we manipulate it to suit our own desires. So, like I said, my opinion doesn't matter. The Father's word says what it says. 1 Timothy 2:9 says, "In like manner also, the women adorn themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array." Okay, this is another position of debate and argument. Now, this is one of those verses in scripture where in only a few words, it gives you a wealth of information that is almost dumbfounding. From this verse, we learn a lot of things. You know, first of all, as women, you should adorn yourself modestly. It says so, modestly. What is modest? You all know what modest is. All this hanging out up here and everything else, that's not modest. That's worldly. That's totally worldly. Now, the world has convinced women that it's boring to dress modestly. It's not going to get you the attention that you want. And women keep falling into all these little traps that the world is setting forth. Modesty shows humble purity. It's not bold. It doesn't cry out, "Look at me, here I am, I'm this, I'm that, check out my body parts, look at how hot I am." See, modesty doesn't scream all that. It allows you to be unobtrusive and a chaste woman with principles. That's what it displays. or modestly dressed women, I guarantee you, any intelligent man out here could see someone dressed modestly and someone sexually dressed and have 110 different opinions about her. He could see the same woman, if he didn't know it was the same woman, dressed both different ways, and his opinions, just based on what he sees, would be totally different. So you have to understand perception, and I'm sure most of you do. That's why so many women dress the way they dress, because they're out there seeking that, here I am, attention. So keep these things in mind when it comes to perception. Now also, to dress modestly is far less in terms of expense. It's comfortable clothing, it's moderate in its shape and pattern, and it's generally decent to look at. It doesn't scream, really look at me, and people don't like that. People want to be looked at, people want to be noticed. A tight miniskirt is not modest, it screams, look at me, and look at what you can almost see about me and say about me. A full skirt falls to your knees, or that is lower, is modest, but see, it doesn't garner the same attention as that miniskirt. Now, also, this scripture instructs women to dress with shamefacedness and sobriety. And shamefacedness is a synonym for modesty. It's reinforcing that you should dress with some decorum about yourself. And to dress with sobriety means to dress in a calm and peaceful way about yourself. It doesn't garner all that attention. You know, we should not be wearing, as women, we should not be wearing alluring, outlandish, garishly bright, and overstimulating clothing. But most of you are aware of what your dress says about you, and you dress to garner the attention that you receive. So if you're a woman who are a believer and are having issues with the way you dress, then you need to make a choice and dress one way or the other. There's no in between. We're going to talk about broided hair in this same scripture. Broided hair is the next issue in the scripture. You know, the primary thinking, one of the primary thoughts is that it refers to the embroidering of things in your hair, like ribbons and gold lacing and all that type of stuff. What it's saying is that decorated hair is another way of saying, look at me, I'm striving for attention. So it's saying to not decorate your hair, not to be all flamboyant and flashy with your hair. Now, for long hair, you know, it's convenient to pull it back into a braid every now and then, you know, and that's for convenience. Now, it'd be nice to interpret the scripture saying that we can braid our hair and do all those things, but we have to understand too, the scripture is talking about these things that bring attention to us. Now, and it's saying that we should do things that are simple and modest. So even with hairstyles, you have to be careful in terms of really violating the context of what modest appearance and dress is. For instance, French braiding is one of those terribly intricate and complicated things to do. It is. It's a lot of work, and you can do things with your hair in terms of braiding that screams, once again, here I am, look at me. Is this modest? I would say not, but that's just my opinion. The Father's Word says what it is. You know, if you mostly wear your hair in a ponytail, that can seem safe and it's conservative. But once again, a lot of women don't want to be safe and conservative and modest in these things. So this doesn't apply. As believers, you have to understand that you're not called to be successful in the world's standards of fashion. See, so many people, especially women, men too, are striving to be successful in the world of fashion according to the world. We want to look like this person. We want to dress like that person. We want our clothes to be fly like this person and that person. We want this, that. Women want to wear these, those, and the others and have everything stand out, pop out, and be out, and it's out of control. But as believers, that's why we have a guide, so we can be led by this all the time. See, the world, like I say, it changes all the time, and it demands and requires us to do things at the drop of a hat. Change from this to that to this to that to keep up with what it wants. So we have to make choices. We either have to stand for His word or go ahead and do what the world wants us to do. Now, Matthew 16:26 says, "For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" There are a lot of people giving up everything to live in the world to get the gains of the world. So be careful about what you choose to do. But if you're willing to sell your soul to the enemy, to the world, to the devil, to gain that success, that notoriety, that nobility, and all these things in the world, then you're free to do that. But it will cost you in the end. Now, the last portion of 1 Timothy 2:9 commands women to avoid costly array. And 1 Timothy 2:10 says, "But which becometh women professing godliness with good works." That's how you present yourself. So you present yourself modestly in your dress and appearance. So your works, your good works can be focused on. It's not about you. See, when we get caught up in self, that's what so many people caught up on self. We want to garner the attention that should be gained for the Heavenly Father. See, we're doing a work for Him, not self. So instead of showing our worth in the world with our outward beauty, ladies, financial success, and the ability to stand out in a crowd, we should show our good works instead. Ladies, you are more beautiful as a modestly dressed, godly woman. That's the kind of woman that the Father wants. He wants a humble, modest, God-fearing woman to be in His kingdom. He doesn't want a woman garnering for all this attention. And He's saying that you can't do His will when you're in this state of living in the world. And you can't. Any of us doing what the world desires of us aren't living according to His will. We aren't doing what He wants us to do. There's no way we can focus on the world and do what He wants us to do at the same time. But it's vitally important that you dress and present yourself in a manner that does not cause your brothers to fall or stumble. See, men will look at an attractively dressed woman and then they will think things, and they will think thoughts that they shouldn't think, and it may affect their walk, it may cause them to stumble, it may weaken them in the Father, and it may cause them to be compromised. See, so you can be responsible for a man's fall also, and that's not what the Father desires. You have a responsibility to yourself and believing men to behave and carry yourself with modesty and chastity. You just do. That's what the Word teaches, because we are all accountable for one another. Men shouldn't cause you to fall, and you shouldn't help cause men to fall or stumble. Look, 1 John 2:16 says, "For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world." The world is filled with all these temptations to wear modern fashions and to embrace worldly attitudes. This is the lust of the eyes and the pride of life. We are not called to follow the world in these matters. We're called to study the Word, to pray with fervor, and to follow the Father and allow Him to guide us in all things. A woman of gentle spirit, modestly attired, is an example to the sinful world of genuinely heavenly beauty. It isn't based on superficial details or external attributes. Instead, true beauty is based on your willingness to reflect the Heavenly Father in everything you do. So ladies, if you truly are a believer or trying to do the Father's will, forget what the world is going to think about you. Think about what the Father is going to think about you. Because see, He is the one that is going to decide whether we make it in or not. And with that being said, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is 2 Bay 7. I'm out.